Hello and welcome to this keynote. My name is Paul Johannesson, and together with my colleague Erik Perljuns, we will in this presentation talk about the relationship between design science and enterprise modeling. In particular, we will look into this question: what artifacts are enterprise modelers designing? Or what are the kinds of artifacts that we look into when we do research on enterprise modeling? So, here's first a presentation outline. First, I will say a few words about design science in general and how it differs from empirical science. Then we look into the kinds of artifacts produced in design science, and I will argue that models are the key artifacts, the most important ones. Then we move into scientific models to see how they can provide some kind of background to understanding enterprise models. Then comparing scientific models to enterprise models, and finally returning to the main question about what artifacts are enterprise modelers designing. So a first distinction can be made here between knowledge questions and design questions, as suggested by Röhl Wieringer in this paper. And this provides a basis for understanding the relationship or the differences between empirical science and design science. A knowledge question, that is when you ask for information about some existing state of affairs, something that already obtains. So, for example, you can ask this knowledge question: what architectures are today used for exchanging information between healthcare organizations? This is a question about something that exists already in reality, some existing state of affairs. In contrast, we can have design questions. They don't ask about some state of affairs that holds or obtains today. They ask for a solution to a practical problem. So, for example, what is an architecture that provides effective and secure information exchange between healthcare organizations? That would be a typical design question. It doesn't ask how is it, how is the situation today. It asks how should a good situation look like, what is the solution to some problem that we perceive or experience today. Sometimes such a design question can be made even more explicit by formulating it as a goal, so to say that the goal is to design an architecture that provides effective and secure information exchange between healthcare organizations. So these are the kinds of questions that we address in design science. Looking a bit more at these design questions, we see that they address problems in practices. So we think that we have some practice here around, for example, the healthcare practice. In that practice, that there are people and maybe other actors also, they perceive different problems. For example, that information exchange is difficult. And in order to address such problem, they can use some artifact, for example, a system. Now, this can give us a tentative definition of design science. This is also the one we have used, Erik and me, in our book here on design science, which has just appeared in a new edition. So what we say there is that design science, it's the scientific study and creation of artifacts as they are developed and used by people with the goal of solving practical problems of general interest. So what I would like to point out here then is that there is always some practical problem in some practice that people experience. We try to solve it or address it, and we do that by creating artifacts using a scientific approach. So a key question that would appear here is to ask, what are these different kinds of artifacts? What could artifacts mean here? Let me then address this in one way by showing you here a set of different artifacts that Offerman and others have suggested in this paper. These are artifacts that they have discovered by studying lots of contributions in the information systems area. And then they have seen that there are things like systems designs, methods, languages, algorithms, guidelines, recommendations, requirements, patterns, and metric. So this is a kind of grounded theory or bottom-up approach to identifying to see what kinds of artifacts are people actually producing here in design science when you look into information systems. And this is certainly one interesting way of addressing this question. Another way, more, maybe we could say more fundamental way of addressing the question of what kinds of artifacts there are, is done by this well-known paper by March and Smith. They identify four broad categories of artifacts that are produced, and they argue that any artifact that you would see can be put into one of these categories. So first, they introduce constructs. These are concepts that provide a conceptualization used to describe problems within some domain and also to specify solutions to those problems. So these are basic constituents that we are using. For example, things like database table and attribute and column, etc. Then we have models. These they define as sets of propositions or statements that provide relationships among these constructs. And they can be used both for representing problem situations and solution statements. While models are more declarative, there are also methods which are more procedural. And a method they define is a set of steps, could be an algorithm or some guidelines used to perform a task. And they are also related to the constructs and some model of the solution space. Finally, there are instantiations, real working systems that you can directly use in practice. The same instantiation is the realization of an artifact in its environment. So they claim that these are the four basic categories of artifacts. If we accept that for a moment, we can see that the models, I would argue, are in fact the central kind of artifact, the key artifact here. First, we say that a model, it includes or relates a number of constructs. So constructs don't appear in isolation on their own. They are always related to each other in some model. If you have a method, this method is based on some model. You can't just have the method in isolation either. You need to have some underlying model for it that it talks about. And then this model directly, you can't maybe use it in some practice. You need an instantiation. But this instantiation, it is an instantiation of a model. So in this sense, the model artifact, it's the one that binds together all the other kinds of artifacts. Okay, so this was a quick background to design science, what it is about, and where models come into play. I will now move into scientific models and see if they can help us to get some grip also on enterprise models. Okay, let's continue with scientific models, models that are used in both natural sciences and social sciences. And these models are about knowledge questions. They're intended to help people to answer knowledge questions, questions about what exists today or what will exist in the future. So it's very much about the descriptive and predictive purposes of these models. The following slides will, to a large extent, build on this book by Michael Weisberg, and he makes a distinction between two kinds of scientific models, concrete models and mathematical models. The concrete models are those that consist of physical objects and they stand in representational relationships with some real-world phenomena. Mathematical models, well, these are abstract structures and their properties can stand in relations to mathematical representations of real-world phenomena. So let's start with concrete models. Here is an example from his book. It is the San Francisco Bay and River Delta system that this concrete model tries to represent. It's a very large model and it consists, its size is about 300 times 400 feet. It is constructed out of several concrete slabs weighing together more than 1,000 tons, and it's quite detailed. It shows things like rivers and canals and slips, dikes, bridges, and so on. It also models quite some complex aspects of this bay. In particular, the hydraulic flow is modeled, such as the water currents being there. And they addressed this issue in different ways, for example, by adding a number of copper strips. So this is not your everyday concrete model. It's one of the maybe the largest concrete models ever constructed. And it was developed in order to study what is the river plan. That was an idea to build two large dams here in the San Francisco Bay to provide fresh water. It turned out this was not a good idea, so these dams were never built. Okay, so this is an example of a concrete model. In order to illustrate mathematical models, let us start with this classical example of rabbits and foxes and how the populations of these vary in size over time and how they can be coupled to each other. The idea here is that when there are lots of rabbits, the rabbit population is increasing like this, then the foxes can get a lot to eat, so they also increase in number. But as soon as there are many foxes, they together eat a lot of rabbits, so the rabbits, they start to decrease in number. And then the foxes will get less food, so they also start to decrease in number. Then fewer rabbits are eaten by these foxes, so again they start to increase in number, and then this pattern, it repeats again and again, as illustrated by these curves. Okay, this could then be described by a mathematical model. The basic one is this Lotka-Volterra model. It consists of two coupled differential equations that describe this dynamics of ecological systems where two species interact. One is a predator species and the other is a prey species. Without going into any details on this model, we can see that the predator population, it's positively affected by the number of prey, while on the other hand, the prey population is negatively affected by the number of predators. And if you solve these differential equations, you will get exactly this graph illustrating that. Okay, so what are the components of such a mathematical model? The basic one is mathematical structure of the model. And such a mathematical structure, it can be of many different forms, such as set theoretical structures. Very common for scientific models, these are structures that consist of state spaces, and typically one of the dimensions is time in such a state space. And then you have the allowable states in these spaces, curves or trajectories that show what is allowed. So for this Lotka-Volterra equations, you would have this state space of three dimensions, the time, the prey population, the predator population, and we saw one representation of the allowable spaces previously. So this is quite common of what you would see of mathematical models in science. A mathematical model is not only this structure, not only this abstract structure, be it a state space or something else. A model, it also includes an interpretation that specifies how target systems ought to be mapped onto different parts of the model. And of course, this doesn't hold only for the mathematical models, it also holds for concrete models. So if we first look here at the concrete model, San Francisco Bay model, okay, it's here, the concrete model consisting of all of these concrete slabs. And then we have the target, the real San Francisco Bay. And there should exist some kind of similarity between the model and the target. For mathematical models, it's essentially the same picture. We don't only have this abstract structure in itself, that is not a model per se. To have a model, you need both this structure and the interpretation. For a mathematical model, you need both the abstract structure and the interpretation. And as I discussed earlier, one interpretation could be that we have rabbits and foxes. It could also be about sharks and fish or about some other animals, or could be even more generic about predators and prey. So different interpretations are then possible of this model, or of this structure, I should say. The model is both structure and interpretation together. It's also possible to give very different interpretations than the ones that were originally used. For example, in economics, Richard Goodwin has made a reinterpretation of this Lotka-Volterra model, where he used for number of predators, he used the workers' share of the national income, and for the number of prey, he reinterpreted that as the employment rate. And he showed that with this reinterpretation, you could quite well describe or represent existing numbers and the relationship between these ones. So you don't, in a model, you don't only have the structure, but also the interpretation. Another distinction that is useful here is to distinguish between models and model descriptions. And a model can be concrete, it can be mathematical, but it can always be described in many different ways. For example, if you have a concrete model, you can describe it by means of blueprints or drawings or diagrams or text and so on. For example, here we have a description of this San Francisco Bay Delta model. And in fact, the model itself, this concrete model, it still exists. It's not used anymore for making decisions or making predictions, but it stands in a museum and is quite an attraction there. And what we see here is the map used in that museum, a map of the model. And of course, we should always note that a model description doesn't uniquely specify a concrete model. There is always some kind of wiggle room. It's very obvious here that this is not, it's a very abstract description of the model. But even if you make much more detailed descriptions, you can always change some details in them. Here's just an example that we can have different model descriptions of the same model. Here are some drawings on the model that were actually constructed before this Bay model was built. Here is a description of the model after it was actually constructed. When it comes to describing mathematical models, it easily becomes more conflated, and you can easily more easily mix them up. And in this sense of distinguishing between the model on the one hand and the model description on the other hand, the point is that for concrete models, you can study and manipulate them directly. You can go out into this Bay model and look at it and feel at it. Or you can look at a model description, some blueprint, or some diagram over it. But when you have mathematical models, they can only be studied and manipulated through their model descriptions, typically that are in the form of equations. Because the mathematical model, or more precisely, the abstract structure of it, you can't really get out and get feel of it and touch it and look at it. You can only study it by means of these equations, these descriptions. So the equations or the descriptions, they become proxies, and you easily conflate them with the models themselves. Still, they are just descriptions, and you could have other descriptions, other differential equations that give rise to exactly the same state space and the same allowable spaces, the same trajectories. So there is a distinction between these ones. Just then, moving to enterprise models, we can see that we here also have the same phenomenon. We have, on the one hand, now I just chose process models as an example of enterprise models. We have process model descriptions, which can be in different languages, for example, in BPMN or in UML or just in text. All of these ones are equivalent in the sense that they refer to the same process model. And of course, I can't really draw a process model or the structure of a process model. Maybe that's also state space or some other set of theoretical construct. I can't really draw it because it's an abstract structure. But we can maybe all agree that these different process model descriptions, even if they are in different languages, they do describe the same process model. And by that, we are now moving into the enterprise models per se, and I will continue by describing how these thoughts about scientific models, maybe how they could help us to better understand enterprise models. So we will look into the similarities between and the differences between scientific models and enterprise models. Okay, first we saw that a scientific model could be seen as an abstract structure plus an interpretation. Could we do the same for an enterprise model and look at these ones also in the same way? And if we can do so, what is the structure then of an enterprise model? Well, for scientific models, we saw that they were often state spaces with different dimensions and trajectories in these ones. In enterprise modeling, well, state spaces might not be that common as abstract structure, but they work very well for many situations. In particular, they work well for process models. And here is some work by Ilja Bieder and others that shows how we can understand and analyze enterprise models, viewing them as state spaces. More common is maybe to view the structure of enterprise models as graphs. For example, for static conceptual models, we would have some graph containing entities as the nodes and associations and relationships as edges between these nodes. But in principle, we could use any abstract structure, any mathematical structure for the structure of enterprise models. So it seems possible to have this use of structure also in enterprise models, just as in scientific models. Moving to the interpretation, we could ask what kinds of interpretations occur in enterprise modeling. One distinctive feature is that the targets here, they are about social phenomena, about enterprises, organizations, and institutions. Certainly, scientific models can also be about these ones, but they can also be about physical phenomena. So in that sense, enterprise models are more narrowly targeted. And furthermore, maybe more important is that these targets, they can be both existing one that exists out there in the world, but they can also be just imagined, being, so to say, mental phenomena in the heads of people that might be realized and might be made existing later on. And that takes us into the question of the purposes of models. Why do we use and need models? And for scientific models, it's possible to identify three main purposes. First one is a descriptive purpose, simply to describe some existing reality, such as the sizes of fox populations and rabbit populations in some concrete situation or in general. But we could also use scientific models for predicted purposes, to tell how things will be in the future, how the population sizes of fox and rabbits will vary in future. And finally, we can use scientific models also for explanatory purposes when those models include some cause and effect relationships. So, for example, we could say that when the number of rabbits is increasing, then later on, also that will lead to, that's the cause of the fox population increasing a bit later. So in that sense, we can also use those scientific models for explanatory purposes. Well, this is somewhat different from the purposes of enterprise models. And here I took a diagram from this paper by Ghisardi and Proper, who discussed why we need modeling and domain modeling in particular. Okay, they recognized those descriptive models, that we can have a descriptive purpose with our enterprise models, and they also made it more detailed here. We can use them for understanding some situation, some domain, some enterprise, but we can also use them for communicating with other people, both, for example, with different domain experts and with engineers. We can also use these descriptive models for model manipulation. So, and for problem solving. So in that sense, this is pretty close to what we would have also in scientific models. But we can also use the models to change the world. We start with some imagined idea, and then we take these imagined ideas, these imagined targets, and we change the world by using them. And here they make a distinction between prescriptive models, where we use them for intervening, designing, planning, and what they call creative models, for bringing about the reality where the model itself helps to bring about a new reality. So let's look into this in a little more detail. Okay, here is how we can use models for descriptive purposes. Okay, now this is a building model, not a typical enterprise model, but this one is now for the Sydney Opera House. We could have this building model, it's described by some drawing in this case, and this building model itself, it describes the real Sydney Opera House. So the model, it describes some existing target by specifying its structure and the behavior that this target actually has in the world right now. So it describes. So this is now the situation where this model is describing something existing using this model description. But we could think about the same building model, also described maybe by the same drawing in this case, but where there's a different purpose. The building model prescribes what we should do in order to create this Sydney Opera House. So we are in a different situation. The Sydney Opera House doesn't exist as yet. Instead, the model here prescribes this imagined target by specifying what structure and behavior it should have, what we want it to have. It doesn't have that automatically. We need to realize this target, and this means that the people have to make this target in accordance with the model, using the model as a kind of recipe or prescription for this building. And one point here is also that when we now say have a model of a building of something physical, okay, it says things about having certain concrete slabs, maybe some iron constructions of certain sizes and forms, and how they should be combined with each other. And when we do that, when we follow what is prescribed in the building model, then we will get a functioning building. And the reason that it will function as intended is that there are certain physical properties of the actual world that will make these concrete and this iron to really work out and function as a building, not something that just falls together, as these physical properties now are expressed in natural laws. Taking now some example instead from enterprise models, I would just like to raise the question here of reference models. Here, reference models have sometimes been defined as this. It is some framework or some domain-specific ontology consisting of related concepts and used to encourage clear communication. Okay, this definition can certainly be extended, but it captures, I think, the basic idea behind a reference model. And now we could ask ourselves, is a reference model descriptive or prescriptive? What is its main function? And somehow it seems that this reference model could have a double function, not relative to the same target as we had in the previous examples. Say that we have a reference model, for example, for some healthcare domain, then it would describe some enterprise or some domain or some practice, stating what exists in that practice. For example, there are patients and doctors and nurses and hospitals and so on and so on. This is a description of what you have in this reference model. But you can also see the reference model as having a prescriptive function. It prescribes how information systems that support this enterprise, this domain, this practice, how they should look like. So, for example, if the information system would be some electronic health record system, then this reference model would tell us how this information system should be structured and how it should be organized. So the reference model in that sense seems to play a double role here, both of describing some practice and of prescribing how we should build supporting systems for that practice. Okay. Another point here is to make a distinction between prescriptive and constructive purposes. And here, Guisardi and Proper, they give an example of a model in a will. And this model might say that, well, some parts should go to the children, some part to the wife, some part to other relatives, and all of that is in a specific will described like that. In this case, the model prescribes, or maybe we should better say that the model constructs the imagined target by specifying its state. And what's different from the previous example with the Sydney Opera House is that this target, it's realized by people just accepting the model. If people recognize the model, believe in it, accept it, well, then we will have this construction of this new reality. They don't have to go around in any physical building process for realizing this state that is described through the model. So there's a difference here that for a model in a will, as this example is, the target will be brought about as it is intended, not due to some properties of the actual physical world, but instead it's thanks to social and institutional features of our world, and these are formulated in laws and regulations. And then desirability and proper, they call that, this means that we create this world by the model. Still, I think there are quite some similarities to prescription. By the way, I just called it constructs here also. But it seems a bit different still from ordinary prescription. But we could also look into other cases where we have this constructive purpose, and where I find it more clearly just constructing or creating some new social reality. Some of our models construct new institutions by defining laws and regulations that give meaning to other models. So for example, we could set up a new model for the institution of inheritance, and then we would define basic notions here, like an heir is this and this, a deceased person or own properties, these are these and these. And if we do that, and if we have the proper power to construct institutional realities, to construct laws and so on, then we will create or construct a new institution in this way. And the target, again, is realized by people accepting the model. Then this new institutional reality that we construct, this lays down the foundation for other models to work as wills, for example. And this is a kind of enterprise modeling where we definitely construct something new, where we do construct a new institutional reality. And we can now see that enterprise models are used in different ways in the design science process. This one illustrates that designing something is not just about designing and developing the artifact. We must start by understanding the problem that is being addressed, and to understand the domain or practice that we are working in. And we should also define requirements on our coming artifact. And for doing this, we definitely have much use of descriptive models. We also, and these descriptive models, they influence our activities. When we then come to the actual designing and developing of some artifact, well, then we also are influenced by prescriptive and constructive models. They tell us what we should build, and maybe for reference models that could appear in standards, then they tell us what we need to conform to, and that will help us in this design, sometimes also constrain us in the design. And certainly there's also the other direction in the models that we create. Many of them are prescriptive, some of them are also constructive. So this takes us now back to our original question about what artifacts or enterprise models really design. Okay, we might think or say, well, they design models, and certainly that's the case, but they could more construct or create or design many things around these models. They could focus on the abstract structures, they could think about the interpretations, what these abstract structures should be mapped to. They could also think about what are the goals of these models. Is it descriptive, prescriptive, or constructive? Another important issue is, of course, to figure out how are we going to describe these models. These enterprise models are not directly accessible We need to have some description of them in order to be able to access them and manipulate them. These model descriptions are expressed in various modeling languages. Those languages consist of different or include various constructs. It could be generic constructs such as entities or classes or associations. It could also be more domain oriented constructs in such as in domain specific languages. And then it could be things like patient, doctor, nurse, etc. It could also be that we are working on the syntaxes of such modeling languages and trying to work out other and better syntaxes, even more easily understandable syntaxes for our languages. And of course, we spend a lot of effort in enterprise modeling to develop different methods. These could be methods for creating new models, or it could be methods for transforming models. Okay, this is of course only a part of all the different things that we as enterprise modelers and as researchers in enterprise modeling do design. But at least I think it's still a fairly large part of what we are doing. But instead of now arguing for this picture, I would conclude by asking what we could even mean by this question. What artifacts are enterprise modelers designing? One way of addressing this question or of interpreting this question is to state that it means that we should look more empirically, more bottom up into what enterprise modelers actually say that they are designing. What is it that enterprise modelers themselves in their practice say that they are creating? And a nice paper that addresses this question, this interpretation, is this one by Delcambre and et al. We could also take more of an ontological approach and ask ourselves fundamentally, what are these enterprise models and what related kinds of artifacts are there that we should design? And here's another nice paper by Guarino and Gisardi Melopoulos that addresses this issue and set up a more ontological answer to the question. But we could also have a third interpretation and say that in order to understand the practice of enterprise modeling, we ask what kinds of artifacts will we need? And maybe the presentation right now has been trying to give some answer along these lines, some first answer in that direction. And by that, I would like to thank you very much for your attention.